Happy Passover.
Happy Passover.
Don't gather around people. Just stay in your homes. And be careful this plague that's around you don't roam. This Passover feels like a real twilight zone. If the Seder to you is worth saving, then you better get Zoom or just call in by phone. For the virus is a-raging. Come Moses and Aaron, who prophesied back then. Tell Pharaoh we Jews need to leave oppression. And don't stand too close to avoid infection. For there's no telling who is contagious. If we don't isolate, then the plagues, they will win. For the virus is a raging. Come senators, congressmen, please heed the call. This plague isn't over, don't open the mall. To get out of Egypt, we need to stand tall. The virus outside raging. Let's wash down our counters and Lysol our doors. For the virus is a raging. Come Jews and all others throughout the land. Though our Seder this year may not be what we planned, let us touch with our hearts what we can't with our hands. It's our freedom that we are craving. So let's celebrate Pesach the best that we can, while the virus is a-raging.
Happy Passover, everybody. I'm Rabbi Susan Abramson, coming to you from my living room. And welcome to Temple Shalom Emeth's Passover Seder. I wanted to talk to you very, very quickly about the significance of Passover this year. First of all, our tradition teaches us that we are supposed to experience personally what it means to go from feeling enslaved or oppressed to feeling liberated and free. And so that's our mitzvah every single year. And so this year we think not only about the past, not only about retelling the story about the Israelites and their enslavement in Egypt, but also about what's going on with us right now. We've just gone through a year of collective trauma, where all of us are continuing to experience the pandemic and have spent many, many, many months or a year, over a year in isolation and all of that that entails and fear and uncertainty. We've just been through a very difficult political year with ending with an insurrection and there's been so much trauma on so many levels because of that. We're now seeing a rise in oppression among the Asian community. We've seen the result of the killing of George Floyd this past year and how we've helped our Black brothers and sisters to realize more freedom for themselves. And so there are so many issues. There's gun violence now that's starting to rear its ugly head again in our country, now that people are getting back out into more public places. So many ways in which we are not free. And this Passover Seder is a time for us to think about all of that and what we can do to help. So I'd like to welcome you to this very important, but also very celebratory occasion, because we end with hope for the future. And those of us who have been vaccinated or partly vaccinated or have an appointment to be vaccinated or are feeling a little bit freer, we can see the freedom in front of us. And so it's a time for us to celebrate the miracle of hope of this vaccine and what it can do for all of us and for our country and the world. I just wanted to explain to you the various parts of the Seder that I have here. So first of all, the Seder plate, which the temple, I believe, gave me as a present many years ago, which is a beautiful, beautiful item. And what I find is that each of the items that I have here has a very specific memory for me that is important to bring out at this time of year, and it connects us to lots of different people and times in our lives. So on the Seder plate, we've got all the traditional elements, the roasted egg, the charoset, which is, I make a special concoction with dried apricots and dried dates, almonds, and a little bit of grape juice and raisins. And I mix that together in a blender. So that's my little special Sephardic charoset. And then we have lettuce karpas. I put a little symbol of the plague this year on there. We have karpas, which is the parsley. We have maror, the bitter herbs, and a bone. I usually have a shank bone, but this year we're going with a chicken bone, and an orange in the middle of the Seder plate, which Susannah Heschel is going to tell us about later. So all of these are the special foods we put on a Passover Seder plate, and they'll all be explained to you later. We have Miriam's cup, which will also be explained. We have water, a bowl with water, salt water, symbolizing the tears that our ancestors shed when they were slaves in Egypt. We have Elijah's cup. You'll hear about that later as well. We've got candles that we light on Shabbat, and a Shabbat and holidays like Passover. And we have a matzah plate. This was embroidered for me by the wife of the senior rabbi where I was an assistant rabbi in the early 1980s. So that is a special memory. And then we finally have an afikoman bag, which my son Aaron made when he was a young boy, which we use every single year. And I'll explain that later as well. And finally, we've got the Haggadah, which hopefully you have at home as well. You might not have the cover of it, but it's the Haggadah that we use at my synagogue that I rewrote all the words to, called Haggadah, Get Out of This Place. So I just wanted to give you a couple of special notes for this occasion. First of all, we have a fifth question this year, which is why on all other nights there's only one Phyllis Berlow, but on this night there are two. Phyllis Berlow, our temple matriarch, is going to participate in our band services in two different iterations. So that's special. And also we've got members of the band singing along with Ben. And we've got members of our religious school introducing each of the sections of the Seder to help make this a more special and more meaningful event for all of us. So sit back, enjoy, and happy Passover.
Every generation, we must see ourselves as if we are personally liberated by Egypt.
We gather tonight to tell the ancient story of our people's liberation from Egyptian slavery. This is the story of our origins as people. It is from these events that we renew our connection with our ancestors' struggle and embrace it as our own.
Our tradition requires that on Seder night, we do more than just tell the story. We must relive it. We must re-experience the liberation from Egypt. We must remember how our family suffered as slaves. We must feel the exhilaration of redemption.
We remember slavery in order to deepen our commitment to end all suffering. We recreate our liberation in order to reinforce our commitment to universal freedom.
For our children and for the children within us, we need to make our stories vivid. So tonight, our table is a stage. This Haggadah is our script. This year's drama is a musical. The more we sing, the more the words reach into our hearts. We mix laughter and tears, humor and melancholy to experience the full range of emotions. Together as family and friends, let us partake of the feast of freedom's sweetness.
And now we continue with our opening song, Haggadah, Get Out of This Place. It's our theme song, and it's also special for this year because we all gotta get out of this place.
Mitzrayim, where the sun oppressive shines, Israelites say there ain't no use in trying.
Miriam, so young and pretty, and one thing I know is true, you will be a hero to the Jews.
Baby Moses in his crib a-crying, mother fretting, she don't know what to do.
Pharaoh says to get rid of the baby Jews.
Oi!
Israelites been working hard.
Oi!
They don't know what to do.
Oi!
Every night and day.
Oi!
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 I've gotta get out of this place. If it's the last thing we ever do, I've gotta get out of this place. Choose, there's a better life for me and you.
Invite my mother and Mindy Standley, a past president of the temple, to light the holiday candles for us this evening.
When the universe was unformed and void, God said, "Let there be light." Therein lies the hope and faith of Judaism and the obligation of our people to make the light of justice, compassion, and knowledge penetrate the darkness in our world.
Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam, asher kedeshanu b'mitzvotav v'tzivanu lahadlik ner shel yom tov.
Praised are you, O God, whose presence fills the universe, who has sanctified our lives through your commandments and commanded us to kindle the lights of the festival.
Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam, shehechiyanu v'kiyamanu.
Praised are you, O God, whose presence fills the universe, who has given us life and strength and enabled us to reach this moment of joy.
Now I'd like to invite my son Aaron to read about the order of the Seder, followed by the temple band singing the song Seder Plan, which I rewrote a number of years ago. And they're all standing together, but this recording was from last year.
Seder is the Hebrew word for order. As in the ancient days of the temple in Jerusalem, a special order was followed to bring sacrifices to God. Our Seder is an elaborate form of thanksgiving. Please join us in a new way to review the order of what is to come.
It's 6 o'clock on a Saturday. Passover crowd shuffled in. A Haggadah is sitting right next to me. It reminds us of where we have been. Begin with the Kiddush wine, wash our hands to show that we're free. We eat the parsley, then we break the matzi, then we tell the Pesach story. matzah and the bitter herb. For those who have had a bad life, we eat a full meal, cause that's part of the deal, and enjoy all we have without strife.
Seder starts with the Kaddish, where you fill the wine cup for the first time, and then you drink.
So now we're going to continue with our first cup of wine, and we're going to take a moment to fill our glasses, and then I would like to invite Howard Eichenbaum to lead us in the first Kiddush. So take it away, Howard.
Page 6, Kiddush, the first cup. The Hebrew word Kiddush means sanctification. The wine is a symbol of the holiness of this moment. We share the sacred story and celebration with one another and with all the generations who have come before us and who will come after us. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu Melech Haolam, borei pri hagafen. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu Melech Haolam, asher bachar banu mikol am, v'ramamanu mikol lason, v'kidshanu b'mitzvotav, v'titein lanu Adonai Eloheinu ba'ahava mo'adim l'simcha. Chagim uzmanim l'sason, et yom chag hamatzot hazeh, zman chirutenu mikrei kodesh, zecher letziat mitzrayim. Ki vanu bacharta, v'otanu kidashta mikol ha'amim. V'moadei kodshecha, v'simcha u'sason hin chaltanu. Baruch atananoi, mekadesh Yisrael v'hazmanim.
Erchat means when you wash or clean your hands. This word recalls back to when Miriam went to a well, and the water inside the well was believed to emit a source of strength and renewal.
And now we're going to continue with the orchats, the washing of the hands, and it is my pleasure to introduce Fran Bloomfield, who is going to do the mitzvah of the washing of the hands, which is so important this year more than anything else. Take it away, Fran.
Slaves eat quickly. They often have no opportunity to wash or time to reflect. Tonight, we are free. We wash and we express our reverence for the blessings that are ours.
Happy Passover to you. Happy Passover to you. Happy Passover, happy Passover. Happy Passover to you. Happy Passover to you. Happy Passover to you. Happy Passover, happy Passover. Happy Passover to you.
The third step in the Passover Seder is the karpas. The karpas is a green vegetable, usually celery or parsley, that we dip into salt water. We do this to symbolize the arrival of spring.
And now I'd like to invite our temple president, Shelley Rosenbaum Lippman, to read about the karpas in the renewal of spring. And so everybody should take their parsley and get ready to dip it in salt water after she says the blessing.
As spring reawakens all that is green, let us reawaken our bonds to the world of nature. We dip greens into salt water and acknowledge through our blessing that there is a creator and a purpose to the universe, that we are partners in the work of creation. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu Melech Haolam Borei Pri Ha'adama. Praised are you, O God, whose presence fills the universe, who creates the fruit of the earth.
And now we're going to continue with the yachatz, the breaking of the matzah.
There are three pieces of matzah on the Seder table under a cover or pouch. Yachatz is the fourth ceremony of the Seder. We break the middle matzah, put one half back in the middle, and the other half is hidden as the afikoman. The afikoman is the other half, and the leader of the Seder will hide it, and the youngest at the Seder will go and find it.
As we break the middle matzah, we think of all those in the world who are feeling broken and incomplete at this moment. We focus on those parts of ourselves which are in need of repair. The middle matzah is broken, but it is hidden inside the whole. We realize how the world around us may seem complete, but how much of it, hidden from view, needs our help. And this year, that's not so hidden at all. So we're going to hide the middle matzah and long for its recovery, our ability to feel whole, and our responsibility to help the world feel whole as well. And so I'm now going to uncover the plate of matzah. And there are three matzot here. So I'm going to hold them up and I'm going to break the middle matzah. And I am now going to put it in Aaron's afikoman bag. And I'm going to hide it somewhere for later. And if you have a child at home, can figure out where I've hidden the afikoman bag, I will get you a prize. Now we're going to continue on page 8.
One of the most important parts of the Passover Seder is the Megid. The Megid is the retelling of the Passover story.
Hal lachma anya de'ahalu avatana be'ara dimitzrayim. Let all who are hungry come and eat. Let all who are in need come and celebrate Passover. Today we are here, next year in the land of Israel. Today we are slaves, next year we will be free.
And now we'll continue with the four questions.
Well, it's 1, 2, 3, why are we asking for? Don't ask me, I don't understand. Why have it this contraband? Bitter herbs, dip twice, and recline right now. Well, it ain't no crime to wonder why. Let me call question why.
Take it away, kids.
Turn to page 8. Free people ask questions. We begin our Seder with questions. Although the custom is that the youngest at the table asks, tradition instructs that all must ask. Ma nishtana ha-layla ze miko ha-lelot miko ha-lelot shebacho ha-lelot anu achim ha-mei tu matzah.
Afilu pa'am echad, halela haze shite fa'amin.
Shebechol halelot, anu ochlin, ben yoshvinu vein misubin, ben yoshvinu vein misubin, halela haze, halela haze, kulanu misubin, halela haze, halela haze,
why is this night different from all other nights? On all other nights, we eat either leavened or unleavened bread. Why on this night do we eat only matzah?
On all other nights, we eat vegetables of all kinds. Why on this night must we eat bitter herbs?
On all other nights, we do not dip vegetables even once. Why on this night do we dip greens into salt water and bitter herbs into sweet harosset?
On all other nights, we eat either sitting upright or reclining. Why on this night do we all recline?
And now we continue with a digression about the four children. In four passages of the Bible, it commands that we are to instruct our children about the Exodus. The Torah speaks of four types of children. One is wise, one is wicked, one is simple, and one does not know how to ask the question.
The wise one asks, "What is the meaning of the laws and traditions God has commanded? You should teach him or her all the traditions of Passover, even to the last detail."
The wicked one asks,
"What does this ritual mean to you?"
By using the expression, "to you," we exclude ourselves from our people and deny God. How did we get this way? Is arrogance and rebellion a form of slavery or freedom?
The simple one asks, "What is all this? Is it a question of reflection, of innocence and wonder, or indifference and apathy? Can one be an innocent bystander to poverty, war, slavery, or genocide?"
The one who does not know how to ask. We all have experienced being so confused, baffled, or overwhelmed with life that we couldn't figure out how to even ask a question. It is up to us to help those who are lost.
So which type of child are you? The wise one, the rebellious one, the simple one, or the one who does not know enough to ask the question? Whether we are children or adults, we have different attitudes, abilities, and interests. The four children can represent each of us, our relationship to our Jewish faith, our relationship to our family, and our engagement with every aspect of life. And this year, I wanted to add that these four types of children can represent our attitudes towards the situation we're in right now with the coronavirus. We can either be the wise one following the directions of the CDC, physical distancing, wearing a mask, gloves, not touching anything, staying home, or we can be the rebellious one, the one who disregards what the authorities are telling us to do and goes out shopping and gets together with friends and in close social contact with people. Or we can be the simple one who just wonders about what is happening and just sits back and thinks, like, I just don't get what's going on, so I'm just going to stay where I am. Or we can be the one who doesn't even know enough to ask the question, the one who just turns off all of social media, doesn't want to know what's happening, doesn't get what's happening, and just has the attitude of, I just have no idea about any of this. So this year in particular, we need to try to be the wise child for the sake of ourselves and our family and our entire community. And now we continue by learning about the story of the Exodus from Egypt.
There are many questions, and now we begin to answer. We move from slavery toward freedom. Our narration begins with degradation and rises to dignity and redemption. Avadim hayinu lafaro b'mitzrayim. We were slaves in Egypt, and God freed us. Tonight we celebrate not what we were or what our ancestors were, but what we have chosen to become. Out of persecution, we have discovered the meaning of our choice, to live as witnesses to one God who calls upon us to mend the world. The Torah recounts the early history of the Jewish people. God commanded Abram to leave his country and his father's house and to go to the land of Canaan, where he would become the founder of a great nation. Abraham and his wife Sarah obeyed God's command and journeyed to Canaan. Their son Isaac married Rebekah. Their grandson Jacob went down to Egypt.
Why did Jacob journey to Egypt? Because his beloved son Joseph had become prime minister to Pharaoh, king of Egypt. When a famine broke out in Canaan, Joseph asked his father and all his family to join him there. And Israel dwelt in the land of Goshen, and they were fruitful and multiplied.
Joseph died, and all his brethren, and all that generation. Now there arose a new Pharaoh over Egypt, who knew not Joseph. And he said to his people, "The Israelites are too many and too mighty for us. Let us deal wisely with them, lest they multiply. And it come to pass that if there be a war, they join our enemies and fight against us. Pharaoh enslave them, and afflicted them with many burdens.
Would not kill the newborn son. Instead, they hid him in their hut for 3 months. When his cries became too loud, Yocheved placed them in a basket on the river. Their daughter Miriam watched to see what would happen. As the Pharaoh's daughter came to bathe in the river, she discovered the basket. She felt pity for the helpless child and decided to keep him as her own. She named him Moshe, which means drawn from the water. Bravely, Miriam asked the princess if she needed a nurse to help her with the baby. The princess agreed, so Yocheved was able to care for her son and teach him about his heritage.
As Moses grew older, he could not ignore the suffering of his people. Once when he saw an Egyptian beating an Israelite slave, he could not control his anger and killed him. Knowing his life would be in danger once the news of this deed spread, Moses fled to the land of Midian, where he became a shepherd.
One day, while tending sheep on Mount Horeb, Moses saw a bush that was burning but was not consumed. From the bush, he heard God's voice calling, "I am the God of your ancestors. I have seen the suffering of the Israelites and have heard their cries. I am ready to take them out of Egypt and bring them to a new land, a land flowing with milk and honey."
God told Moses to return to Egypt to bring the message of freedom to the Israelites and to warn Pharaoh that God would bring plagues on the Egyptians if he did not let the slaves go. Moses was such a humble man that he could not imagine being God's messenger.
"I will be with you," God promised Moses. With this assurance and challenge, Moses set out for Egypt. His brother Aaron helped him.
When Moses and Aaron asked Pharaoh to free the Israelites, Pharaoh refused. It was only then that God brought 10 plagues on the Egyptians. Each one frightened Pharaoh, and he promised to free the slaves. But when each plague ended, Pharaoh did not keep his word. It was only after the last plague, the death of the firstborn of the Egyptians, that Pharaoh allowed the Israelites to go.
And now we continue with the 10 plagues.
I see 10 plagues arising. I see trouble on the way. I see bloody rivers flowing. Frogs, diseases, hail no day. Bugs and bees will bite. Pharaoh, you will get it right if you don't let us go tonight. Hope you got your sons together. Hope you are quite prepared to cry. If you don't stop and reconsider, watch out for angels in the sky. Bugs and bees will bite. Pharaoh, you will get a fright if you don't let us go tonight. Bugs and bees will bite. Pharaoh, you will get a fright if you don't let us go tonight.
I will
will turn the water. Into blood.
All right, go.
Here come the frogs.
Here come the ghouls.
Hey, say, here come the frogs.
Here come the frogs. Hold. Here come the ghouls.
Smile.
Here come the ghouls.
I'm the plague of lice, and I'm so itchy all over.
The plague of flies.
We are the plague of flies.
Shoo! Shoo, you pesky flies! Get out of here!
Alexa, Simon says, uh-oh, it's going to hail today.
Oh, it's going to hail today.
Yes!
Hail? Oh, no!
Hail!
It's a plague. I know. It's on my face.
Lightness. Darkness.
That was a great job, kids, of explaining the 10 plagues, and now we are going to continue by putting a drop for each plague onto our plates. So we are going to put our pinkies up and we're going to say the name of the plague in Hebrew and dip our pinky in the wine. And then we say the English, we're going to put that drop on our plate. And the reason why we do this is because no matter how much joy we are feeling at this moment, our joy is diminished, like our cup of wine is diminished, because we know of the experience of what it's like to be in a plague and how people are suffering. So we can't be whole when we and others are feeling diminished. So ready? Dam, blood, tsvardeya, frogs, kinim, lice, arov, beasts, Dever, blight, Shechin, boils, Barad, hail, Arbe, locusts, Choshech, darkness, Makat Bechorot, death of the firstborn. And then we lick our finger, we lick our pinky to be able to taste the sweetness of having overcome these plagues. And now we continue with a song and an introduction about Dayenu. And it's great to have Andy Fight with us today, who actually was standing at the shore of the sea when he read this next page. Take it away. And he's going to be followed by Phyllis Burlow, our temple matriarch, who is going to sing the song Dayenu, which I hope you'll all join along with.
We have so many reasons to be grateful to God tonight for the blessings of freedom and dignity, friendship and family, prosperity and health. Any one of these would have been enough. Had God taken us out of Egypt without bringing judgment against them, Dayenu. Had God brought judgments against them without carrying us across the sea, Dayenu. Had God carried us across the sea without caring for us for 40 years, Dayenu. Had God cared for us for 40 years without giving us the Sabbath, Dayenu. Had God given us the Sabbath without the gift of the Torah on Mount Sinai, Dayenu. And had God given us the Torah without bringing us into the land of Israel, Dayenu. How many are the gifts that God granted us?
Thank you.
And so it was that God brought us forth out of Egypt with a mighty hand and with an outstretched arm, with great terror, with signs, and with wonders.
The experience of the Exodus made us a free people. No matter how oppressed we are, deep inside we remain free. We know that power cannot vanquish freedom. In each generation, every individual should feel as though he or she had actually been redeemed from Egypt. As the Torah teaches, you shall tell your children on that day, saying, "It is because of what God did for me when I went free out of Egypt." For the Holy One redeemed not only our ancestors, God redeemed us with them. As it is says, God brought us out of there so that God might bring us to the land promised to our ancestors.
Therefore, let us rejoice at the miracle of our liberation and thank God who brought us from slavery to freedom, from despair to joy, from mourning to celebration, from darkness to light, from enslavement to redemption. Amen.
And now we're going to continue on page 19 by explaining three of the main parts of the Seder plate and why each of them is there, the Pesach, the Matzah, and the Maror. And that's going to be followed by Susannah Heschel explaining to us about why there's an orange on the Seder plate.
Rabban Gamliel, the first century sage who compiled the Haggadah, taught, "Those who have not explained these three things during the Seder have not fulfilled their obligation, Pesach, Matzah, Maror."
Pesach. When the great temple of Jerusalem was still in existence, our ancestors ate a special sacrificial offering called the Pesach, or the Paschal Lamb. The word Pesach means to pass over. The offering was eaten as a symbol that God passed over the houses of the Israelites. As the Torah teaches, you shall say, "This is the Pesach offering we offer to God because God passed over the houses of the Israelites when God destroyed the Egyptians, but our homes God saved." Exodus 12:27.
Matzah. Why do we eat matzah? To remember that even before our ancestors' dough had time to rise, God saved them. As the Torah teaches, and they baked the dough which they had brought from Egypt into matzah, and it did not rise since they hurried out of Egypt, and they could not delay, nor had they prepared other provisions for themselves.
Why do we eat bitter foods? To remember that the Egyptians embittered the lives of our ancestors with hard labor in mortar and brick, and in every manner of drudgery in the field, and worked them ruthlessly in all their labor. The bitter herbs must be chewed and tasted. It is not enough to talk abstractly about oppression, to analyze the causes which led to slavery, to read about the forced labor camps. To the best of our ability, we are to experience the lives embittered by oppression. To taste the bitter herbs is part of the process of feeling the affliction of body and spirit of an enslaved people.
Hi, my name is Susannah Heschel, and way back in the 1980s, I decided to put an orange on the Seder plate. I want to remind everyone what it was like in those days. In the early 1980s, there was a terrible, terrible disease going around San Francisco that was seemed to be affecting mostly gay men. It was ultimately called AIDS, a disease of the immune system. And we were all begging President Reagan, especially the gay community, was begging President Reagan to put funding into finding some kind of treatment for this terrible disease. And he refused. And there were also ministers running around saying, "Oh, well, it's punishment from God for being gay," that kind of thing. At any rate, I decided, it was around 1984, I think, to put an orange on the Seder plate. It was a tangerine, which is what we had in those time of year. And everybody would take a piece of the tangerine and make the bracha over fruit and eat the tangerine and spit out the seeds of homophobia. We ate the fruit out of solidarity with gay men and lesbians. And we did this because, you know, if you peel an orange, there's never a segment missing. All the segments are there, and they cling together, which is what a community should be doing, clinging together, never with one missing, never with one rejected. The custom somehow caught on. I'm not sure why, but it did, and I'm very glad. It became well known, but I also discovered around the late 1990s that some people were saying they put an orange on the Seder plate out of solidarity with women on the Bima, which I thought was a little silly because women are on the Bima. They're women rabbis, so it's not such a great, chiddush. At any rate, I'm happy for the custom, I'm happy for the solidarity, and I hope that we continue as Jews always to speak out where our voices need to be heard. I wish you a Chag HaShev Sameach.
And now we continue with the second cup of wine. So everybody, hope everybody has wine in their wine cups, and rise if you are able to join us in the singing, in the introduction and the singing of the second cup of wine. Take it away, Hal Torman.
Praised are you, O God, whose presence fills the universe, who has redeemed us and our ancestors from Egypt, who has brought us to this night when we eat matzah and maror. We will sing a new song of thanksgiving for our redemption and for our spiritual liberation. Praise are you, O God, Redeemer of your people, Israel.
Baruch Ata Adonai, Eloheinu Melech Haolam, Borei Pri Hagafen. Praise to you, Adonai, our God, Sovereign of the universe, Creator of the fruit of the vine.
And now I continue with Miriam's cup, which is the cup which we fill with water, and a lot of times we go around the table and everybody puts a little bit of water in Miriam's cup. And Tina Torman is going to explain why we have water in Miriam's cup, why we do this ritual, and then we're going to sing Miriam's song to the tune of I Saw Her Standing There. Take it away, Tina.
We place Miriam's cup on our Seder table to honor the important role of Jewish women in our history and tradition. O God, you sustain us with water. May we, like the Israelites leaving Egypt, be guarded and nurtured and kept alive in our personal and communal journeys. May we use our powers of sustenance, nurturance, and healing, symbolized by Miriam and water, the source of life, to bring redemption to all we see as we travel together through the wilderness of time.
Well, she was our Jewish queen, came on to the scene when she saw Moses was brought to Pharaoh's lair. Miriam ran home, got her mother, ooh, when she saw her brother there. Then she crossed the sea when the Jews, they did flee. And before too long, she held her timbrel high. The women all danced with each other, ooh, when they saw her chandelier there. They were saved from doom, so their voices boomed, and they thanked dear God on high. They danced through the night, and they held each other tight, and before too long, they fell in love with her. We raised Miriam's cup at our Seder, ooh, for her bravery that day. For her bravery that day. For her bravery back there.
Perhaps is a ritual hand washing we do before eating anything dipped in water as a way of remembering the rules of purity we kept in temple times.
Page 22, Rafzah.
Praised are you, O God, whose presence fills the universe, who has sanctified our lives through your commandments and commanded us to perform this washing of the hands.
The Motzi Matzah is when we say the usual blessing for bread and add a second blessing to the specific commandment of eating matzah. Combined, they are called the Motzi Matzah. The matzah is called the bread of the affliction and represents the lives of the Jewish people while in slavery along the escape from Egypt. Traditionally, the top up and broken middle piece of matzah are held together for the blessings.
We are now coming to the Seder meal. As we ordinarily begin with the breaking of bread, we begin tonight with the breaking of matzah. Say the prayer. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam hamatzi lechem min haaretz. Blessed art thou, eternal our God, King of the universe, who bringest forth bread from the earth. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam asher kishanu b'mitzvotav v'tzivanu al achilat matzah. Blessed art thou, eternal our God, King of the universe, who hast sanctified us through thy commandments and instructed us to eat unleavened bread.
The bitter herbs, usually horseradish, remind us of our bitter lives as slaves in Egypt.
And now we continue with the blessing over Maror, and Judy Wasserman is going to lead us in that blessing. And Judy is the wife of Steve Wasserman, who actually made this maror, these bitter herbs from scratch, and it's pretty potent stuff, trust me, I know. So take it away, Judy.
Praised are you, O God, whose presence fills the universe, who has sanctified our lives through your commandments and commanded us to partake of maror.
Karef or karif is the Hebrew word for sandwich. Karef is the stage in the Seder when we eat bitter herbs between two pieces of matzah.
For the Hillel sandwich, we take a little bit of the sweet charoset and we put it on a matzah. And then we take a little bit of the bitter herb so that the bitter and the sweet are together, and we make a sandwich out of it. To the sage Hillel, eating matzah, charoset, and maror together was not a trivial matter. To him, slavery and freedom were merged into one historical event. The bread of poverty became the bread of freedom and should be tasted together with the bitter maror and sweet charoset so that one should know both the bitterness of slavery and the joy of freedom. In times of freedom, we must not forget the bitterness of slavery. And in times of slavery, in times of oppression, we must keep alive the hope of freedom. Please enjoy your Hillel sandwich.
Shulchan Aruch, Passover dinner is served.
And now I hope you will enjoy your own personal dinner at home. I'm missing the cooking that's done here. I'm never the one who cooks. That's not my part of my real skill set. But enjoy your meal. And during our meal, we have a very, very special presentation for you. We have got the Not Quite Ready for Passover players. So if you are home alone, or if you would like to just watch something while you eat, this is a very, very special skit that State Representative Ken Gordon and Middlesex District Attorney Marian Ryan and a few other members of our congregation, Phyllis Burlow reprising her role as God, Jeff Nussbaum, who's usually Aaron, and Lisa Diorio is our reporter, as she sometimes is. And we have new this year also Joe Meyer in the role of Pharaoh and Donna Meyer in the role of Miriam. So please enjoy.
I'm glad you stopped by, District Attorney Marian Ryan.
I remember last year when I came to Temple Shalom Emeth, and we had a wonderful time. We sang parodies, and you dressed up as Moses, and you made a complete mockery. I mean, I guess you called it a funny little skit about the Exodus story.
This year, with the governor's order of social distancing, we have to do things a little bit differently.
I hope that you're not going to be making a parody out of the coronavirus epidemic. It's making an awful lot of people sick.
The Jews, we have such suras. If we don't laugh, we cry.
Well, be that as it may, but as an officer of the law, I really feel compelled to interrogate you.
Oy.
I have four questions about why this year is different from all other years.
Four questions? Well, that sounds familiar.
In all other years, people get dressed up when they go to a Seder. Why are you wearing an old shemat? What's up with that? And in other years, we wash our hands twice during the Seder. This year, everybody's washing their hands every 5 seconds. And Ben Silver keeps playing Happy Birthday to them over and over again. I understood that you only washed your hands twice during Seder. I mean, what are we going to do? Is everybody going to have their own bottle of Purell next to their seat? And before the other Seders, when I've come here, I would have gone to the hairdresser for a blow dry. This year, I don't know, hairdressers are considered non-essential. Look at me. Never mind. Don't look at me. How can I go to a religious event looking like this? And at all the other Seders, I've been sitting around the table with the rabbi and her mom and her family and all the wonderful members of Temple Shalom Emeth. What did you do with them?
Just like in the Passover Seder, we ask four questions. And then we don't answer them. Instead, we go back and we tell the story of the ancient Israelites escaping Egypt. But then we digress before we get to the actual story.
Okay, that sounds more complicated even than most of my cases. But all right, okay, I'll go with you. Let's proceed.
Through the power of modern technology, I'm now going to zoom with you through the ages back to the time of Moses. Hey, that's Miriam, the sister of Moses. Hey, Mir. What you doing?
I'm saving my baby brother Moses from a ruthless decree of the Pharaoh. Pharaoh's killing the Jewish male children. I'm putting him in this basket and floating him down the river. Maybe he'll be saved by a nice family. Right, like that'll ever happen. Who wrote this nutty script? He'll be eaten by crocodiles.
Miriam, this is God. Have faith. He will be taken in by the family of Pharaoh. Pharaoh will raise him as if he was his own son and bestow upon him all the riches and benefits of the palace. Moses will be happy until he realizes that Pharaoh's riches come at the expense of the Jewish slaves. He will witness a slave being beaten by a slave master, and he will slay that master. And then he will become the leader of the Jewish people. This is how it will be written.
You gotta be kidding me. And excuse me, who are you and what are you doing while I'm trying to tell this story?
I'm sorry. I'm Middlesex District Attorney Marian Ryan. I'm from the future. I was tweeting on my iPhone. It's really important to tweet everything. You get really bad cell phone reception in this area, but I think my tweets can still get out.
Middlesex District Attorney? iPhone? I don't understand a word you're saying. Tweeting? Is that some sort of prehistoric bird? Can't anyone pay attention for more than 2 seconds in this day and age? Well, as an offering to Pharaoh, I'm going to take that iPhone from you and put it in the basket. Maybe he'll take that Tweety thing and spare my brother.
Brother Moses, God has commanded you to approach Pharaoh and demand that he let the Israelites go. We gotta obey. She's God. Remember what happened to the burning bush? It kept burning like forever and wasn't even consumed.
Yes, Brother Aaron, but why me? I'm a poor shepherd. I'm not even an Israelite.
Yeah. About that. Moses, actually you are an Israelite. M.O.T., member of the tribe, as they say. Chosen one. My name is Miriam, your real-life sister. That Egyptian family you're living with only found you after I put you in a basket and floated you down the river when you were an infant, not knowing whether you'd live or die. Then I saw who picked you up, and I pretended to be a housemaid so I could look after you, so you're an Israelite.
Whoa, this is a lot to take in. I'm not Egyptian royalty. You're not a maid. Is my other sister really Egyptian, or is she Israelite too?
You mean Cleavanka? Yeah, you know the guy she married? Israelite. She converted. The Pharaoh knows none of this. He's pretty self-absorbed. The only thing he pays attention to is that Tweety box on the Chai phone. I took it from some district attorney in a place called Middlesex. Never heard of it, but he loves that thing.
Let's go back to the palace. We'll tell Pharaoh to let our people go.
But how can I even get near him? Remember, I ran away years ago after I killed that slave master. He may want to kill me when he sees me.
Good point. Okay, I've got an idea. He's holding a press conference this afternoon to talk about how great he is. Raise your hand, flatter him, then tell him God's directives.
Pharaoh, this is the third day our rivers have turned to blood. You promised we would have clean water again by Passover. What are you going to do about that?
Whoa. I never said we would have clean water by Passover. I don't even know what Passover is. Don't ask me crazy questions. You're a bad reporter.
Pharaoh.
Yeah?
Pharaoh. You know the rivers were turned to blood by God as one of the 10 plagues that will be visited upon Egypt if you don't free the Israelites. When are you going to free the Israelites?
Look, we have had to close the borders to keep the foreign plagues from sneaking into our country. The Israelites are my slaves. They're the best slaves. They're the best, okay? They do all the jobs that real Egyptians would never do. I commanded them to follow me on the Tweety box, okay? If they leave, how will I explain the loss of a million followers?
Pharaoh, after blood, God will cause frogs to descend upon this land. Flies, lice, cattle disease, locusts, darkness, and more.
Ooh, any Tweety birds?
When will you give up?
I've done the best job of any pharaoh in history dealing with this situation. This tough situation is the best. Okay, I've done the best. No one could possibly do better. You go tell God I won't give in. Well, I'll say I give in, then I'll deny it, and I never said that I ever did.
If you don't let the Israelites go, I happen to know that the plagues are going to get so bad, you're going to run out of toilet paper.
You're not nice, and your God's not nice.
Pharaoh, this is your last chance. If you don't let my people go, then a terrible plague will make your people sick, and some of them will die. If you ignore this plague, it will get worse. Pharaoh, even the markets will crash.
When you put it that way, you know, I'm starting to think that maybe I don't need the Israelites as much as I thought. I mean, okay, they are the best. They're the best at doing what I say to do, okay? But maybe there's other people. Maybe we can make a deal. I'm thinking maybe you and I, because we're the best, we can make a deal and all the Israelites can go, okay? Good riddance.
Dear Ryan, I hope we've answered some of your questions. Even though we may look like schlumps this year and are washing our hands every 5 seconds and can't be together, we retell the Passover story to give us hope that God will save us and help us live like free people again. Because this year we remember that we caused souris to innocent Egyptian people who lost their jobs through no fault of their own during the plagues. This year we dress as if we have no jobs. Because we remember how quickly we had to flee Egypt. Not only did our ancestors not have time for their bread to rise, they did not have time to visit their hairdresser either, and so we have messy hair. And we remember how the Pharaoh never really washed his hands, and so we wash our hands over and over again. And we remember how our ancestors had to each individually find his or her way out of Egypt, guided by Moses in the distance. So by staying isolated in our own homes, we feel like we can be alone together in these video boxes. Does that all make sense?
Okay, you've proven your case. But who is that who keeps knocking at the door?
Oh, yeah, that's Elijah. This year we can't let him in because he's supposed to be in quarantine. Happy Passover!
Happy Passover!
So long, everybody. Stay safe and healthy.
So now it's time to find the afikoman. Afikoman is the Greek word meaning dessert, And it's the time when the children usually run around and try to find where an adult may have hidden that half of the matzah that I broke off before and put in that special bag. And everybody's got their own tradition. But so for today, for our virtual Seder, I'm going to tell you that the afikoman is hidden somewhere on this table. And you can't see it right now, but it is hidden somewhere on the table. And the clue to where it is has something to do with the fact that there is something not quite right about the picture I am showing you right now, something that's out of order in the Seder. And the afikoman is hidden around or beneath that thing which is out of place on the Seder table. So if you can figure this out, send me an email at rabbi@shalom-emeth.org and I will get you an afikoman prize. So good luck.
Berech is the step we take right after enjoying our meal. This is when we thank God for all the delicious food we have just eaten, and this is when we can say everything that we're grateful for from our Seder.
Take it away, Ben Silver, to lead us in the special blessing on page 24 of your Seders.
I hope now all of you have enjoyed a wonderful Passover meal, and it is now time for us to sing together the Birkat Hamazon, the blessing after the meal. And in the very first section of the blessing, there's some call and response where you sing and then I sing. So I'll start off by singing Chaverai Nivarech, and then the very next line, I hope you have the words in front of you, you will sing and then I will sing. And I'll talk through that as we go along. So now we begin. Chaverai Nivarech, and now you sing together. Yehi Shem Adonai Mevorach Me'ata V'Ad Olam. And I answer. Yehi Shem Adonai Mevorach Me'ata V'Ad Olam. Birshut Chaverim Nivarech Eloheinu She'achalnu Mishalo. And now you sing together as a group. Baruch Eloheinu She'achalnu Mishalo. Uvtuvo chayinu. And I answer back. Baruch Eloheinu she'achalnu mishalo. Uvtuvo chayinu. Baruch hu uvaruch shemo. Baruch atah Adonai. Eloheinu melech haolam. Hazan et haolam kulo bituvo. Bechein bechesed uvrachamim, hu noten lechem lechol basar, ki leolam chasdo, uvtuvo hagadol, tamid lo chasar lanu, ve'al yechsar lanu, mazon leolam va'ed, ba'avur shemo hagadol. Ki hu elzan umfarnes lahachol, umetiv lahakol, umechin mazon lechol briotav asher bahara baruch atah Adonai hazan et hakol. Kakatu vialchata v'savata uveirachta Et Adonai Elohecha, Aha Aretz Hatova, Asher Natan Lach, Baruch Ata Adonai, Aha Aretz Vial Hamazon. Uvne Yerushalayim, Ir HaKodesh Bimhera, Biyameinu, Baruch Ata Adonai, Bohone berachamav Yerushalayim, Amen. Ose shalom bimromav, hu ya'ase shalom, aleinu v'al kol Yisrael, v'imru, Amen.
Okay, let's get ready for our third cup of wine. And please rise if you so desire.
Baruch atah Adonai. Eloheinu melech haolam,
Orei peri hagafen.
Amen. Blessed are you, Adonai, our God, sovereign of all, creator of the fruit of the vine.
Now we're going to continue with Elijah's cup on page 27. And Joel Douglas and his family, Emily and Margaret, have a very special presentation of Elijah's cup for you this evening. You won't believe it. I don't.
This is Elijah's cup. With it, we invite Elijah to join us and bring his passion for justice into our lives. According to Hasidic custom, we pass Elijah's cup around the table so that each person can pour a little wine into it until it is filled. In this way, we recognize that we must act together, each contributing our best talents and energies to bring Elijah's promise to the world. So, Margaret, if you want to pour a little in. And I will pour a little in. Dripping. And Emily, if you could pour a little in. Okay. And so now we invite the children, our hope for the future, to open the door and welcome Elijah. And Emily, for our family, could you please have the honors? Okay, so now let's see if Elijah came. Look, just a couple of drops left.
Who's peeking in from outside our doorways, telling us to bring peace to our world? Who's coming in to drink from his wine cup? Everyone knows Elijah. Who's telling us to stop persecution and to be kind to all that we see? Who's reaching out to promise redemption? Everyone knows Elijah. Elijah did prophesy. Elijah was there, he was. To our Savior he will fly to drink our wine. To drink our wine. Ba 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 ba.
Continue the fourth cup of wine on page 29. Cooperman family, take it away.
We have completed the telling of our ancient story. Why do we tell this story year after year, generation after generation? Because it is the foundation of our hope and the basis of all Jewish dreams. After expulsion and inquisition, pogrom and Holocaust, what gives us this kind of strength? Only one thing, hope. For the future, because we saw the sea split, because we were freed from slavery, we can dream. We know that God has purposes in human history. We know that power is not history's last word.
We raise this cup of hope with all of our dreams for ourselves, for those we love, and for the world. Baruch atah Adonai, Eloheinu melech haolam. Orei pri hagafen.
Praised are you, Lord our God, whose presence fills the universe, who creates the fruit of the vine.
And now we come to the Nirtzach, the conclusion of our Seder. We give thanks for the land of Israel and its citizens, our brothers and sisters who have embraced the sick, the poor, the homeless and the fragile from the four corners of the earth. We join with them in building the land and in the realization of our prophetic dreams for peace. L'shana haba'a b'Yerushalayim. Next year, may we celebrate in a Jerusalem at peace. Next year, may we celebrate in a world healed and free. It is now my pleasure to introduce my good friend, Rabbi Kinneret Shirion, who was the rabbi in Modi'in, Israel, where I just stayed with her for a while in January of this year. And she's going to bring us greetings from the land of Israel. Take it away, Kinneret.
I am Rabbi Kinneret Shilyon, a good friend of Rabbi Susan Abramson. And I just want to send you greetings of a wonderful Pesach. May your Passover be splendid, even in light of the limitations that are on our lives, all of our lives globally. And my special blessing this year is that you should move from bidud to chirut, from isolation into freedom. And may we all feel that very soon.
We'll join together for our closing song. Next year, may we all be free. Take it away, Ben.
Verily rocking in Israel, up a heck of a day, in the heart of the town, down Tel Aviv way, all over Beersheba, and in Jerusalem, all the Jews are rejoicing in the freedom. We really hope that by next year, everyone will be free. From whatever ails them, to finding liberty. We ask for good fortune for the poor and oppressed, and may God grant them peace and happiness. Oh, Jews and Israel, we hope we know, from strength to strength, we hope you go.
Remind me that I am responsible for your world. Don't allow me to stand idly by. Inspire me to act. Teach me to believe that I can repair some corner of the world. When I despair, fill me with hope. When I doubt my strength, fill me with faith. When I am weary, renew my spirit. When I lose direction, show me the way back to meaning and compassion. Thank you, Rabbi Naomi Levy, for that beautiful conclusion and benediction. Chag Pesach Sameach, wishing you, your family, and all of us happiness, health, and peace. Amen.